Roosters and the Dons are amongst the league's most vicious rivals. The two teams are the most successful clubs in the history of the VFL-AFL competition, both sharing the record for 16 premierships. As a result, it is not surprising that these teams have met multiple times and amassed some of the league's greatest and most memorable moments. But for both clubs, success, which had been such a guarantee, a natural part of the order, one could say, has been lost in the new millennia. The Blues have fallen far from the dominant on-the-field power. No wooden spoons for 105 years, while since 2002, they have five. For Essendon, well, they recorded a spoon win in 2016, their first since the dark days of the 1930s, and are most noted for no finals wins since 2004, and rocked by one of the most dramatic scandals to ever hit the league. These two clubs are far from the on-field powerhouses that they once were. Come the start of a millennia, though, this fall from grace that the two clubs had faced seemed unthinkable. The Blues coming off from the epic 1999 preliminary final upset against the Dons, which shocked the landscape, and were on the top of their game in 2000, winning 13 wins in a row, and dominated by Anthony Koutafidis, who was putting in a season to remember. With legendary coach David Parkin still at the helm, but the Blues seemed set for another era of glory. For Essendon, though, well, 2000 rings true as a year to never forget. Obliterating the competition, the Dons produced the most dominant ever season that has ever been seen, with only one single loss and an average winning margin of 51 points. The Dons truly flew up to win the premiership flag that year. This video is not an examination on how mighty the fall has been for these clubs, although that shall be discussed in the past, but more of an examination of its history. The Blues and the Dons were both inaugural members to the Victorian Football League, and it was Essendon who would be the first of the teams to record premiership success with their first ever premiership in 1897, the first in the league. Although through a round robin, the Blues, their first taste of success came about a decade later in 1906, and then followed with premierships in 1907 and 1908 to record the league's first hat-trick of flags. The first meeting in a final was the 1904 semi-final, and this was the only time that Carlton and Essendon played against each other at Victoria Park, which was Collingwood's home ground. It was a close and tight affair, with Carlton winning only by 3 points. With the 1908 grand final being the first clash between Carlton and Essendon in a grand final, the Blues, again, it was a tight match, with the Blues winning by 9 points on a dour windy day in what was described as a highly inaccurate affair from both sides. For Essendon, though, the coach of the Blues that day was John Worrall. Worrall was seen as the difference, and for Essendon, well, they were about to luck out as Worrall was about to be sensationally axed by his own players and would not coach Carlton to the 1909 and 10 grand finals. Grand finals which Carlton would both lose. Instead, Worrall, the first proper coach, the first super coach, was to cross to the same olds, and with his tough standards of professionalism that he brought to the Blues, well, he brought that made Carlton a powerhouse. Well, he brought that to the same olds who were able to reap the benefits from Worrall's coaching prowess with back-to-back wins in 1911 and 12. Roots of this rivalry, though, probably identified as emerging in the 1940s. The same olds were now the Bombers, revitalized from their on-field depression of the 1930s, and in the 40s they were blitzing the league, with a star-studded team that included triple Brownlow medalist Dick Reynolds as playing coach and dual Brownlow medalist Bill Hutchinson. This was a star-studded team. Meanwhile, though, Carlton in the 40s were experiencing a renaissance of their own. Although they may not have had the names of Reynolds and Hutchinsons, but the club boasted a crew of reliable champions that made Carlton a competitive force. It was 1941 when the clubs would meet for the first time in the finals of that decade. Essendon won convincingly in the preliminary final, 68-93. The winners of the 45 and 46 premierships, Carlton and Essendon, it was natural that these two teams were to meet in 1947. 1947 is a grand final that's often forgotten, overlooked. In the days before television, the lack of a full game replay has meant the dramatic grand final is often overlooked and forgotten when talking about the great grand finals. But 47 was Carlton and Essendon's greatest grand final appearance. Essendon dominated the first half of the match. They had 10 more scoring shots to the Blues by quarter time, but inaccurate kicking saw the Bombers lead by a point. The second quarter was a repeat of this. Again, Essendon dominated the play and were clearly a better side, but poor kicking saw the Bombers only narrowly extend that lead to 11 points by half-time. But Carlton may have been remarkably accurate, with a half-time score of 8 goals, no points, 48, to Essendon 8 goals, 11, 59. The third quarter opened in an arm wrestle, and that's how the quarter played out. By the main break, Essendon still had a lead of 11 points, but it would be the final quarter where the game would be most dramatic. Carlton took the early initiative to no avail. A tight tussle, but the final 10 minutes were to be Carlton's. Carlton's Frederick Davies kicked his fourth to bring the margin to a goal, with Davies again marking 20 metres out from goal, close towards the end of the game. It seemed the ledger was about to be tied up, but Davies missed. The margin was now only 5 points. But this move proved invaluable. With 40 seconds remaining on the clock, the ball was thrown in from the boundary. Carlton ruckman Fred Baxter hit the ball to advantage. Enter Fred Stafford, who snapped the ball on his non-preferred foot. Carlton now led by a point. Essendon would win the centre clearance, but time ran out. Carlton had won in remarkable fashion. For Essendon, though, goal-kicking inaccuracy would cost them again the following season in 1948, when they kicked a remarkable 7-27-69 in the first drawn grand final against Melbourne. They would lose in the replay the following week. Although goal-kicking woes had cost them in 47-48, the Bombers would have their chance for revenge against Carlton in 1949, and it helped that goal-kicking-wise. They now had the greatest goal-kicker of them all, the great John Coleman, marking and kicking everything. The 1949 grand final, though, was a one-way affair for the Bombers as they blitzed the Blues by 73 points. Coleman, in his first season of football, kicked 6 goals in that match, with his 6th bringing up his 100th goal for the season. For Coleman, his role in the emerging rivalry was to be further fueled in the last match of the season in 1951. Coleman was the it player, a sensation who could not be stopped. Many defenders resorted to aggressive tactics to try and quell Coleman, and in the final match of the round, Carlton's Harry Casper spared no mercy in harassing Coleman, and finally Coleman responded, swinging a punch at Casper.
And at half time he came in and threw his jumper off. He got stripped and is putting his clothes on. He said, "I won't play again. That bastard grabbed me down below." He said, "I'm finished."
I had his head down, head between his knees and head down, and I said, "No." He says, "Bugger." He said, "I'm going home." He said, "When the marks like that do that to me," and he said, "they report me for it." And I just gave him the general talk and got him out there again.
He went out and he played on Ollie Grieve, one of the greatest fullbacks of all time. He kicked 5 goals in the next 5 minutes.
But Coleman was reported and as a result suspended for 4 matches. He missed any chance to play in any finals. And well, Essendon would make it to the grand final. They went down by 11 points.
But I think if he had played in the 51 grand final against Geelong, I think the result may have been different.
For Coleman, he would have his chance to get revenge against the Blues, but not on the field. As a coach in the 1962 grand final, after a dominant first quarter in which Essendon kicked 6 goals to Carlton's 1, the second quarter was a reverse of this, with the Blues scoring 4 goals to Essendon's 1. But every stage of a game, Essendon led, and would wrestle control back in the third and fourth quarters to win the match comfortably against the Blues by 32 points. The Carlton from 47 to 68 had been a period of gloom, with its 2 grand final appearances in that time being comfortable losses to Essendon. After sinking to its lowest position in 1964, the Blues knew it was time for a change under the administration of new president George Harris. Carlton poached Ron Barresi. Barresi brought over professionalism and winning culture, and under Barresi the Blues had been reinvigorated. And it would be in 68 where Carlton broke through, meeting Essendon twice in that final series. First in the semi-final, which Carlton won easily, before meeting Essendon again on a blustery September's day in the grand final. Attended by a then record crowd of 116,828 spectators, it was not an attractive spectacle, with inaccurate kicking from Carlton with 7 goals and 14 behinds. Essendon did get close, within a point by the 20-minute mark of a quarter, but the Blues hung on. Despite not kicking a goal in the final term, Carlton won by 3 points, their first premiership in 21 years, and this was the first and only time that a team won a grand final, despite Essendon having kicked more goals. For both clubs, 68 was to be a sliding doors moment. For Carlton, it was the beginning of a great era of success that saw Carlton a regular finals and flag contender for the next 30 years. For Essendon, though, this brought a close to its era from the 40s to the 60s, where they were a regular contender. The Bombers missed finals in 69 and then dropped to 11th in 70 and 71. For Essendon and Carlton, the 70s were a contrasting decade, The 70s were perhaps Carlton's greatest, but for Essendon, one of its most memorable. But no blood was lost between these two teams. Essendon are well known for its Anzac Day encounters, but it hasn't always been played against Collingwood. In fact, one of the most memorable Anzac Day matches was played in 1975 at VFL Park in Waverley between Carlton and Essendon. Both sides were undefeated and in front of over 77,000, the biggest crowd at the park at that stage. And they were not disappointed. A ferocious match occurred, with a young Simon Madden making his mark with 6 goals. The Bombers were victorious by 17 points. The next time these teams met in 75, there were some scores to be settled, and with the umpires having their hands full, 8 players were reported facing 11 charges. But Carlton were out for revenge, and they kicked 14-1 in the second quarter, going on to win the match by 80 points. The intensity and ferocity of this rivalry, though, would emerge in the 80s and peaked between 1981 and into the early 2000s. Under the guideship of former Richmond champion Kevin Sheedy, the Bombers roared back to life. Sheedy was no fan of Carlton, a veteran from Richmond's era of greatness, which included many brutal affairs against the Blues. Sheedy would bring his hatred to Carlton, to the Bombers. 1981 was Sheedy's first year at the helm of the Bombers, and it is marked by some of the most memorable games ever played between these two sides. The first of these memorable encounters was the 1981 Night Grand Final. The Bombers struggled in the first half of this match, recording 1 goal to half-time. But with Tim Watson leaping over players, the Dons recorded a stirring cover-behind win to win by 24 points. But 81 is noted by one of the game's most memorable home-and-away matches ever. Princess Park in round 20, the Bombers were aiming for their 14th straight win. But the Blues were looking to end their streak, and leading by 26 points with 10 minutes to go, the Blues looked home. But Essendon began its charge, with the margin now down to 14 points. Carlton captain Mike Fitzpatrick attempted to slow the game down. As a result, a controversial free kick was paid against Fitzpatrick for wasting time, a rarely applied rule. And with the resulting free kick resulting in a behind, which will be consequential later on. It would be Neil Danaher, though, starring, who produced some last-minute heroics that would ultimately win the game for the Bombers, slotting through a memorable goal that would ultimately see Essendon go on to win the game by a solitary point, and thus the beginnings of a modern rivalry had been entrenched. In 1983, the Blues and Dons would meet in the elimination final. The Blues, the previous premiership victors of 81 and 82, were looking for a chance to go 3 in a row. But the Essendon Bombers were at their beginnings of their run, and, well, in this encounter, it was the Bombers, knocking off the reigning premiers by 33 points. Come the 90s, the Blues and the Dons were the two Victorian powerhouses, with 1993 being a year that truly solidified the intensity of this rivalry. In their first encounter of the year, in what was to be Essendon legend Dustin Fletcher's first match of 400, Carlton and Essendon were involved in a shootout, with Carlton captain Stephen Kernahan kicking his 5th, coming with minutes left in the match to tie the match. Sticks instructed his men to kick it to him, and they did. Kernahan marked the ball, and the siren blared. Any score would do as he lined up for a kick, but instead, the ball went out on the full. It was a draw, the highest draw in AFL history, at 132 points apiece. Later on in the year, the two teams would meet in the first finals under Light, and spectators were treated to a classic match, a tight encounter for the entirety of the match. Kernahan again starred with 6, while Williams gathered 32 possessions, and Tim Powell kicked 2, making a statement for his continued selection. But for Essendon, the loss was taken with solace. With many key players missing, such as a young James Hurd, the Baby Bombers would rebound, and after surviving a scare in the preliminary final against Adelaide, would go into the 1993 Grand Final, with Gavin Wanganeen winning the Brownlow, upsetting the favourite Carlton champion Greg Williams in the lead up to the Grand Final. Baby Bombers went in full of confidence and made a statement early. The match was a one-sided affair. For Carlton, only Stephen Kernahan produced a memorable performance with 7 goals, while Essendon ran away and literally ran away, with Michael Long running the field to kick one of the most memorable goals ever. Although Stephen Silvani swears it touched, but whether it was or wasn't would make little difference for the Baby Bombers winning an equal 15th premiership against arch-rivals Carlton. The next year, in the grand final rematch, the Dons would again take bragging rights in a thrilling win in round 9. The Bombers took the bragging rights in 94, but in 95, Carlton's year of dominance, the Blues would, with another classic match in round 7 in front of over 70,000. The Blues took victory by 8 points. Through the 90s, these were the two giants. But the most memorable encounter occurred in 1999. The Blues were very average in 99, while Essendon were clearly the best team in the competition and had taken care of Carlton comfortably that season. Thus, when the Blues had somehow made it to qualify for the preliminary final that year, many felt it was a mere formality to an ultimate Essendon premiership, with Bombers supporters so confident that they were lining up for grand final tickets outside the MCG before the match had even begun. The Blues and Anthony Koutafidis, though, had other ideas. In the weeks leading up to the match, former Essendon player, now Blue, Glenn Manton, told his teammates, "I hope we stick it up to the Bombers next week," while President John Elliott took Essendon in the media for having cheated its way to the 1993 Premiership, a reference to the fact that Essendon had recently been found guilty of breaching the league's salary cap that year. An ironic statement considering what Carlton were to be found guilty of later. In the preliminary final, the Blues got off to a quick start, jumping the Dons, kicking the first two goals and taking a 16-point lead by the first quarter. This was further extended by four goals at half-time, but everyone knew the Bombers were coming back. And they flew to life in the third quarter, kicking seven goals in the third quarter and hitting the front. It looked like Essendon had survived the scare and settled. The grand final, now wait, right? No. But Anthony Koutafidis had other ideas. Moved into the midfield, Kuta was instrumental, producing one of the greatest quarters by a player ever seen. He won clearances, had 10 kicks, 2 hand passes, 6 marks and 2 goals for the quarter. The Blues had blasted back and retook the lead. They were determined to spoil Essendon's day. With 2 minutes left in the clock, Essendon attacked hard. Mark Johnson kicked a goal, narrowing the margin back down to 2 points. And with 55 seconds left in the clock, Mark Mercury gathered the ball from 25 metres in front and snapped for a goal. But he just missed. The margin was now a point. Essendon, though, would regather the ball from a poor kicker. And Dean Wallace ran, looking to clear the ball towards forward 50. But Fraser Brown ferociously tackled Wallace and was able to tackle him to the ground. The ball spilled free, Carlton cleared it, and they won by a point in one of the most memorable finals games ever played.
They are into the grand final. Carlton is into the grand final.
Essendon were left to lament on the pain. In 2000, Essendon were out for vengeance. While Carlton were now a serious contender with Anthony Koutafidis in his prime, the Blues and the Bombers looked to be destined for a grand final appearance that year. The Bombers, though, were clearly the best side in the competition, and with Carlton and Essendon's round 20 clash, the AFL world waited patiently in front of 91,000 plus people, one of the largest home and away attendances ever. The game would be tied for 3 quarters, with a halftime lead of 1 point to Essendon and then 2 points to 3 quarter time. But in the last quarter, Essendon asserted themselves, winning by 26 points, ending Carlton's streaks of 13 wins, while Essendon's streak would only continue for one more week. This round 20 clash, though, was most noted for a serious knee injury to Anthony Koutafidis, who would miss the remainder of the season. And come the 2000 preliminary final, what was to be Carlton's last preliminary final appearance, the Blues were a wounded side, and the Bombers were on a mission. It was no repeat of 99, Essendon won by 45 points. In 2001, two classic matches were played. With no Silvani, Bradley or Koutafidis in round 3, Essendon had continued its 2000 form. But an undermanned Blues stunned the Bombers with a 17-point victory. Later that year, in Craig Bradley's 350 match, he would face old enemy Essendon. And with the Blues needing to cement a final spot, Matthew Lapham would star with 5 goals that helped the Blues claim an 8-point victory against the Bombers. Then it all fell off for the Blues in season 2002. With its old veterans retiring, Carlton plunged to last and ladder for their first wooden spoon. What was worse, Carlton were found guilty of breaching the salary cap, resulting in a loss of draft picks and a huge fine. Meanwhile, Essendon, who had been found guilty of salary cap infringements in the past, had lost players from the 2000 team because of the salary cap. Players such as Damien Hardwick and Blake Carosella would leave. Essendon, though, did continue to compete, but they weren't the unbeatable Bombers that they were in 2002. Essendon recording its last final victory some 20 seasons ago now. And both clubs have been etched in mediocrity at best, and utter chaos, dysfunction, and scandal at worst. Essendon would face its own major scandal with a drug scandal that ranged many years, resulting in player suspensions, coaches sacking, and loss of draft picks. But even with this era of mediocrity, both clubs have managed to always find something when playing each other, and some classic matches have resulted. In 2006, in what was known as the Bryce Gibbs Cup, 16th versus 15th, a far cry from the top of a ladder clash of 2000 occurred in Heritage Round. Scott Camporelli, now a Don, the match would live up to its heritage roots with ball rolls and biffs, and the game resulted in a draw. While the next year in 2007, Carlton recorded its greatest ever comeback, trailing Essendon by 48 points midway through the second quarter. The Blues fought back, with Brendan Favola enjoying his finest hour of the club with 8 goals to help steer Carlton towards a memorable 3-point win. The Blues and the Dons would meet in their most recent finals encounter in 2011, but it was an underwhelming match as the Blues easily won for their first finals victory in 10 years. But this Brett Ratton and Chris Judd-led Blues were as good as it was going to get for Carlton for some time. Carlton would qualify for finals in 2013. Under controversial circumstances as a result of the Essendon drug scandal that saw Essendon disqualified from the finals, with old rivals Carlton taking that place instead. Both of these clubs, even in the darkest years, have managed to find a way to win against one another. In 2016, Essendon, with 34 players suspended, got up against the Blues in round 23 by 24 points. The Blues in 2018, in their worst start to the season the club had ever faced, well, worst season ever. One of their two wins that year came against the Bombers, their first win of the year. The Blues and Bombers are both amongst the competition's largest, most followed clubs, with a history of success and legends. Clubs built and standing on the shoulders of giants. These two clubs have fallen far. While it was therefore seen befitting to match the Bombers up against the Blues for their 150th celebrations in 2022, Essendon would go through a period of chaos that year. But 12 months on, though, Essendon have since sacked another coach in Ben Rutten, had off-field chaos, and has resulted in Brad Scott taking the helm at Essendon, who have shown promise in 2023. For Carlton, after a very promising 2022 season that failed so close to the finish line, the Blues have gone backward and seem to have reverted to old habits. Now they have off-field chaos, with rumours swirling about the future of the coaches, board and players. These two clubs remain giants off the field, but sadly they are not on the field. Can the wheels turn? Can the memories, intensity and history between these two rivals be reflected in the modern day? Maybe they will always show a way to get up against one another, even when they are down. The race to 17 still seems to be a bit off for these clubs. While Collingwood looks to be chasing down the hills to join them at the top of 16, time will tell if their current lists are the ones to take them back to the pinnacle of Everest. These clubs' histories demand. Thank you guys, and if you enjoyed this, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe for more.